The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
And we made it to a Friday. Barely, but here we are. Welcome to it. I hope you have a great weekend planned. If you're in Washington, D.C., perhaps you're going to the White House. Why? Because believe it or not, Donald Trump is actually holding another Rose Garden event tomorrow. Why? Because one super spreader event wasn't enough? Asinine. The man is just insufferable. I mean, just unbelievable. I guess today he did a thing with Rush Limbaugh. Now, I don't listen to Rush Limbaugh, so I don't know, but somebody posted a clip on the Twitter machine of, I guess Donald Trump was on the phone with Rush Limbaugh. And, well, let me play for you the audio that I just heard, because this happened. I guess Donald Trump was threatening Iran because he's such a big, bad man. Here's what he said.
Right. And Iran knows that, and they've been put on notice. If you fuck around with us, if you do something bad to us, we are going to do things to you that have never been done before.
Oh, ew. Here's my question. Was that on the air? Now, when Donald Trump said, fuck around, Limbaugh didn't even flinch. He didn't look up. He didn't do it because I'm looking at the video. I'm looking at the video. And, so he didn't react, but what's weird is if that went over the air, Rush Limbaugh is liable for a fine of up to about $350,000. But you have to, people need to complain. The FCC won't just say, ooh, Donald Trump said fuck on Rush Limbaugh's radio show. That's in how many households? How many markets? People have to complain. But the audio is right there on the Twitters. Our pal Aaron Rupar tweeted that. So I need someone to tell me if that went out over the air or if that was maybe in a commercial break. Anyway, let me know. 954-889-6410 is the number. Somebody's calling from the 954 area code. So somebody's local here in South Florida. Hi, who's this?
Hi, it's David.
Hi, David.
Yes, North Miami Beach, but I used to work a lot in Hollywood.
Great
show yesterday with Howie Klein. Next time you have questions about ancient history, I was a licensed history teacher, but I actually did some grad work on it. So, I mean, you basically covered the whole Romans and Jews and Christians. That was pretty good.
And I'm so not the authority. I mean, as I've said on this program before, my entire religious education comes from watching the movie The Ten Commandments. So, you know, take what I say with a grain of salt. But, you know, when you ask me where does anti-Semitism stem from, all I could think of is the Jews killed Jesus. And, you know, according to my husband, that's basically it with a little more. Yeah.
And I would certainly thank Henry Ford. A lot of what Hitler was based on was sort of Hitler was sort of recycling Henry Ford stuff.
Yeah, well,
and so unfortunately, there were a lot of people with limited education who were, you know, the captains of industry in America. Gee, that never happens, and so they spread these falsehoods. So people have someone to hate to hide the fact that they are taking all the profits, not just profit sharing. But besides the so-called blood libel, you talked about the fantasy that Jews use children's blood to make matzah, yada, yada.
I didn't talk about
the fantasy. The fantasy that, you know, Jews as taxpayers, they're taking all the money. Well, yeah, Jews weren't allowed to own land in many places, so they had to be good in education, of you know, money lending, any portable job they could take with them. And of course, in bad times, they're a convenient scapegoat. Oh, they took it all, rather than, oh yeah, the powers that be messed up. Yeah, so I wish you a good Shabbos, as one secular Jew to another, and despite what the Chassid said, no, women are not merely the reflection of men.
Okay.
But like some
all right, you're going
say,
way off in yeah. the weeds here. Let's okay. All right, thank you for the call, David.
Take care.
Appreciate it. Bye bye. Yeah. That, wow, that was out there. But yeah, it goes back to the discussion that Howie Klein and I were having yesterday, spurred by a listener, Joe, who tweeted to me during or after, or just during the debate, during the vice presidential debate the other night, on why, where does anti-Semitism come from? So this is a discussion that's been going on for a couple of days. Another discussion that's been going on for a few days, I should tell you, is with my friend Brad Friedman. Unfortunately, his discussion is not going on Twitter anymore because he's been suspended. Now, I'm doing double duty today. I'm doing this program, and I'm also guest hosting the Bradcast tonight for Brad and Desi. And a good number amount of time when I fill in for them, I recycle interviews that I do on this show because, frankly, I have some great interviews and they deserve to be heard by more people than listen. Today, I'm giving them a fresh interview. And I mentioned this guy to you yesterday. I recorded it yesterday afternoon. And I was so impressed by him. He's a historian. His name is Kenneth C. Davis. And his new book is called Strong Man, The Rise of Five Dictators and the Fall of Democracy. And it's fascinating. And the interview was really good. So I decided I'm going to use that on the Bradcast today, which airs on the Progressive Voices Network at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. And all the time, they run his show over and over again. My show only airs once. His is on like, you know, five times a day or something like that. I may be exaggerating a little bit. But anyway, Brad, whose main issue, you know, he reports on everything at the Brad blog, but his main issue is, you know, election security, election integrity, things like that. And he's very well researched. If nothing else, Brad Friedman is a journalist. I'm not. I'm a talk show host, but he's a journalist. And he tweeted something the other day. It said, 39 days until election day, and the entire state of Georgia does not have a single working database for any of the 159 counties where the Georgia Secretary of State forced every one of them to use a new, untested, 100% unverifiable touchscreen voting system. Just unfucking believable. And then he tweeted under it. He said, holy crap, read this short thread and, if you can, the short legal filing. Looks to me like the state of Georgia will have to dump their horrible new, unverifiable, $100 million touchscreens and immediately go to hand-marked paper ballots for all at this point. Wow. At Coalition Good Government warned years ago, and then he retweeted Jeannie Dufort's thread. Well, unless Brad Friedman deletes those tweets, Twitter tells him he will not be able to use Twitter. So he challenged it. He wrote to them, and you know, he appealed it. And apparently with Twitter, when you appeal a ruling, like you're banned for however long, you only have 124 characters to respond. They don't even give you the new double amount. Anyway, he wrote, I told them I'm a journalist and gave them the link to the federal court filing. I had to use a URL shortener because he only had 124 characters. That includes the email from the Secretary of State's office to all election officials in all 159 counties in the state telling them to stop testing on the systems that new databases would soon be set, blah, 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 blah. And he got a reply to his appeal that says, thank you for your patience as we reviewed your appeal request for account at the Brad blog regarding the following. And then it put his tweet. And then it says, our support team has determined that a violation did take place. And therefore, we will not overturn our decision. You violated our rules against posting misleading information about voting. But it's not misleading. What Brad is posting there is the truth. And he says you will not be able to access Twitter through your account due to violations of the Twitter rules, specifically our rules around violating our rules against posting misleading information about voting. So he's banned. So here's Brad's dilemma. Either he deletes the legitimate tweets, or he's not allowed to tweet anymore. Unbelievable. So anyway, I'm just passing that along to you because Brad can't tweet it out, but you can read his whole dilemma at bradblog.com. And that's where you can hear the show tonight. It'll be posted by 8 Eastern. That's when it airs on the Progressive Voices Network and stations around the country. But it'll be posted by then. I'm not quite done with it yet because I got this little show to do. So welcome to it. Did you hear... yesterday, I had mentioned that Nancy Pelosi had teased that today she'd be talking about the 25th Amendment. Right? Here's what she said yesterday, and what I played yesterday, looking forward to what was going to happen today.
Well, I don't know what the prospects are when we hear people saying I'm young and I'm a perfect specimen, instead of addressing the fact that 50,000 people were. Infected yesterday, nearly 1,000 people died. What are we talking about here? Tomorrow, by the way.
Today.
Tomorrow?
Today.
Come here tomorrow.
Okay.
We're going to be talking about the 25th Amendment, but not to take attention away from the subject we have now.
Okay, so that was a nice little tease. And so today I was there. I logged on to C-SPAN first thing this morning to find out what time it was happening. It was 10:15 this morning, and sure enough, in walks Nancy Pelosi and Jamie Raskin, both wearing their masks, which they both kept on the entire time. None of this taking it down to talk in the microphone stuff. This is serious shit. And Jamie Raskin is a constitutional expert. Before he joined the House of Representatives, he was a constitutional law professor. I mean, this is his thing. Howie Klein knows Jamie really well. And what he said yesterday is Jamie Raskin is probably the most knowledgeable person in all of Congress when it comes to the Constitution. So I found his statement today really fascinating. Now, we're on a limited timetable here. I will play the entire 6 minute or so piece on Brad's show tonight, where Jamie Raskin explains what this is all about. Here's an excerpt of that, so you can hear what they're talking about.
It's never been necessary, but the authors of the 25th Amendment thought it essential in the nuclear age to have a safety valve option. And as they often said, we have 535 members of Congress, but we only have one president.
Yep.
In the age of COVID-19, which has killed more than 210,000 Americans and now ravaged the White House staff, the wisdom of the 25th Amendment is clear. What happens if a president, any president, ends up in a coma or on a ventilator and has made no provisions for the temporary transfer of power under Section 3? Who has the powers of the presidency at that point? Is it the chief of staff? Is it the vice president? Is it the secretary of state? This situation is what demands action under Section 4. I wish that Congress had set up this permanent body 50 years ago. It did not do it, but we do need to do this. Certainly in the next Congress. Framers of the 25th Amendment knew that you could not always count on the cabinet to act, and so Congress has a role to play, and that role must be totally bicameral and totally bipartisan. And the legislation that I introduced today seeks to establish a 16-member commission that could act in the event of such an emergency, and a chair, a 17th member, chosen by the 16 members themselves. 8 members are chosen from medical personnel, physicians, and other medical authorities. The other 8 members are drawn from the ranks of former high-ranking executive branch officers, including former presidents, vice presidents, attorneys general, secretaries of defense, treasury and state, and surgeon general. So the commission is entirely bipartisan, and of course, under the 25th Amendment, it can act only in concert with the vice president, who is the key actor under the 25th Amendment.
So he goes into further detail. That was only 2 minutes out of like a 7 or so minute long statement. It's fascinating. So I hope you'll listen. If you listen to the show, to tonight's broadcast, you'll hear it. And again, you can get it at bradblog.com. It'll be up by 8 o'clock Eastern tonight. So There was other big news today, though, too, of course, because it's a day ending with a Y. I long for those. I remember August. August used to be known as a slow news month. Nothing happened in August. Everyone would go on vacation. Therapists take the month of August off. It's not like that anymore, and it hasn't been for about a decade, because there is no such thing as a slow news day. So today we let off with this unbelievable story. 13 people have been charged in a domestic terrorism plot. Fuck the alleged. This is domestic terrorism. In a plot to overthrow the government and kidnap and assassinate the Democratic governor of Michigan, Gretchen Whitmer. Several suspects associated with a group called the Wolverine Watchmen. They call themselves a militia group, and some in the media refer to them as militia as well. Make no mistake, they're not a militia group. They're a group of white nationalist domestic terrorists. Call them what they are. If it was a group of black men, you'd call them thugs in a gang. This is not a militia. They are a group of domestic terrorists that call themselves the Wolverine Watchmen. They were allegedly gathering intel on local law enforcement and training to attack the Michigan Capitol building. Whitmer, I got to say, she was so poised when she got up before the camera. She thanked the FBI agents for foiling the plot, and she called out Donald Trump for giving comfort to those who spread fear, hatred, and division.
So let me say this loud and clear. Hatred, bigotry, and violence have no place in the great state of Michigan. If you break the law or conspire to commit heinous acts of violence against anyone, we will find you. We will hold you accountable, and we will bring you to justice.
Good. Well, so, you know, the FBI charged 6 people with plotting to kidnap her. 7 others face state charges of targeting police and threatening to instigate civil war. Investigators believe some of the defendants participated in those armed protests around the Michigan State House back in whenever it was in the spring, when they were protesting Whitmer's lockdown orders. You know, she was being tough on COVID because she was trying to protect the people in her state. It's stunning what is going on. And I saw this. Let me see if I can't find this audio, because I got to play this for you. This is astounding. I know, here, I got it. All right. A sitting sheriff in Michigan was interviewed by a news organization. You just have to hear this. Hold on. I'm going to pull it up. And actually, I'm going to try to bring up the video. So if you are watching on any of the video streams, you'll be able to see it as well. Here we go. All right. I need to move it a little bit. I'm just going to go ahead and play it so you can hear what's going on. This is an interview with a sitting sheriff in Michigan, and they're talking about this case. This is somebody from Fox 17 in Barry County, Michigan.
Barry County Sheriff Darleaf, who does say he knows these guys. He, quote, has never had lunch with them or anything like that, but has ran into them at some of these rallies. He said they've always been nice and respectful to him, adding they deserve a fair trial.
What?
Michael and William Null were among the first charged Thursday for their alleged roles in the plot to kidnap Governor Gretchen Whitmer. The brothers from Plainwell and Shelbyville are now charged with providing support for terroristic acts on top of weapons charges. Their West Michigan homes raided Wednesday night.
Was able to hear them say, FBI, have a warrant for your arrest. Come out with your hands up.
A neighbor of William Null spoke with Fox 17 under the condition of anonymity. They witnessed the raid and were shocked hearing what it was related to.
I had heard that there was a lot of militia people. Their right to do so, but to the extent that we just found
it's
out
coming
last
up
night,
this is not the
totally
this is not the part
about that.
The Null brothers had ties to militia groups and were frequently seen at local demonstrations, including at this rally in protest of Governor Whitmer's stay-at-home order held last May in
there
Grand
you
Rapids. You can see William Null on stage alongside Barry County Sheriff Darleaf, a guest speaker at the event. We spoke with Sheriff Leaf Thursday night.
This is what you need to listen to. Listen to this.
I've got other duties to do. It wasn't our investigation. So I was shocked. I did not see this coming with those guys, but still, we can't convict them in the news media here. They do have a right to a fair trial.
Okay.
Leaf says he doesn't know of Null's alleged involvement in the plot and doesn't have any regrets about sharing a stage with him.
Do you have any regrets from being on stage, sharing a stage with the guy who's now being charged in a plot to kidnap the governor?
Well, it's just a charge.
Just a charge.
They say a plot to kidnap, and you got to remember that, are they trying to kidnap? Because a lot of people are angry with the governor.
Oh.
And they want her arrested. So are they trying to arrest, or was it a kidnap attempt? You can still, in Michigan, if it's a felony, you can make a felony arrest.
Oh,
and
my God.
NCL 764.4 or something like that, 0.5, somewhere on there. And it doesn't say if you're an elected office that you're exempt from that arrest.
Oh, so my God.
I have to look at it from that angle, and I'm hoping that's more what it is. In fact, these guys are innocent until proven guilty, so I'm not even sure if they had any part in it.
Oh, my God. So that is the sheriff of Barry County, Michigan, who said, we don't know that they were going to kidnap her. Maybe they were just trying to arrest her. Citizens, because people are angry with her, they can arrest her. Really? If this was a group of black men with long guns who decided to go and arrest you, for instance, what would happen to them? Would you say, oh, it's just a citizen's arrest? These are just charges? This is
bullshit.
This is not only bullshit, this is fucked up. You know, this whole militia thing where these Republicans, I'm sorry, it's the only way to put it, Republicans are okay with white guys carrying around AR-15s and similar weaponry because and claiming they're in militias, as if that means anything. Where, but if you're a peaceful protester marching down a street, say in St. Louis, you're a thug and a criminal and a terrorist. I'm just the opposite world nature of how they roll is sickening. By the way, Dana Nessel, who is the top law enforcement official in the state of Michigan, she's the, I guess, the Attorney General of Michigan. She commented on that video with the reporters, Ross Jones from WXYZ in Detroit. But Dana Nessel said, let me make this abundantly clear. Persons who are not sworn licensed members of a law enforcement agency cannot and should not arrest government officials with whom they have disagreements. These comments are dangerous. But that was the sheriff of Barry County, Michigan. God, I feel like calling him. I so feel like calling him. But I don't have the number handy. I just, you know, it popped into my mind. All right. You know me. All right. I'm going to see if Barry County, Michigan Sheriff's Office. Let's see. Oh, there's a phone number. I think I'm going to have to call it and see if the sheriff is available. Let's see if this will work. Yes, that's the right phone number. Oops. Hold on. I'm going to try calling it. Let's see if this will work. I probably shouldn't, because I don't know if Michigan is a once. I'll tell them we're on the air when I call. That's all. All right. So let me. Whoops. That's not the number I'm trying to call. Hold on. No, not that number. Where is the, there's the dial. I know this is, you know, it's live radio. What can I tell you? All right. Let's call. That's not it either. No, I'm having problems here. Okay, it's 269, yes, 948-48. There we go. All right, let's call. We're calling the Barry County Sheriff's Office in Michigan. One ringy-dingy, two ringy-dingy.
You have reached Barry County Central Dispatch.
Okay.
If you have an emergency, please hang up and dial 911.
Okay.
To speak with a dispatcher to report a non-emergency complaint, press 1.
No.
If you need to reach the Barry County Sheriff's Office directly to obtain a police report, speak with a deputy, or any other general inquiries pertaining to the Sheriff's Office, please hang up and dial 269-948-4805. Okay. Again, that phone
hate it when this happens. All right. Well, now we need to call the other number. You know, it's a bureaucracy. So it was, what was it? It was 269. 948. This is live radio, everybody. 4805. Okay. All right. We are calling again. One ringy dingy. Two ringy dingy. Oh, and it won't. What happened? It didn't go. That was the number. Maybe it's not going to go through. I may have to call, you know, off the air on my own time. It's unavailable. How interesting. So the number, a call to the sheriff's office won't work. All right. I guess it's time for a word from our sponsors. Not really our sponsor, but this is a sponsor. This is an ad that the Lincoln Project put together for the latest product that Dear Leader is hawking. So take it away, Donald Trump.
I got back a day ago from Walter Reed Medical Center. I went in, I wasn't feeling so hot. And within a very short period of time, they gave me Regeneron. A short 24 hours later, I was feeling great. And that's what I want for everybody. If you're in the hospital and you're feeling really bad, Regeneron. We have hundreds of thousands of doses that are just about ready. You're going to get better. You're going to get better really fast. Regeneron. Because I feel great. I feel like perfect. I want to get for you what I got. Regeneron. And you'll see some amazing things happen. You're going to get better. You're going to get better fast, just like I did.
Oh my God, Regeneron, you're going to get better. You're going to get better fast, just like I did. Oy, Donald Trump, give it a rest. Just go home already.
Wearing a face mask, I don't know, somehow I don't see it for myself. Can you take it off because I cannot hear you?
I'll just speak louder, sir.
Oh, okay, good. You want to be politically correct. Go ahead.
No, sir, I just want to wear the mask.
Go ahead.
It affects virtually nobody. It's an amazing thing.
I don't wear masks like him. Every time you see him, he's got a mask. He could be speaking 200 feet away from it. He shows up with the biggest mask I've ever seen.
Funny news, the President of the United States now confirming to the world that he and the First Lady of the United States have both tested positive for the coronavirus and they will quarantine.
It is what it is.
It's the end of the world as we know it. On the Progressive Voices Network.
Oh boy, I didn't mean for all that echoing to go on. It's just another technical difficulty. All right, I told you we have a great guest coming up today. And, well, with the news this week that all these people are testing positive for coronavirus from the White House, I've decided that they're to be known as Covidiots. And everyone's favorite, or not, Covidiot, Stephen Miller was diagnosed last week. So it makes sense to talk to the author of a new book called Hate Monger. It's about Stephen Miller. It's written by our guest, Jean Guerrero. Jean, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
I don't take pleasure in anybody being sick. I mean, but I got to tell you, if anybody at the White House deserved to get this, I'm sorry. I can't think of anybody more heinous than Stephen Miller, though it's close because there are a number of characters like that in the White House. But Stephen Miller is the guy responsible for the really ugly immigration programs of this administration, right? Is that how you got involved with reporting on Stephen Miller?
Exactly. I mean, I've been reporting on the impact of his policies, reporting out of the busiest border crossing in the United States in San Diego, Tijuana. And I'd been looking at the family separations, interviewing parents who had presented legally at ports of entry, had no criminal records, had committed no crimes, and who had nevertheless been systematically separated from their children, including the case of one father who had his one-year-old baby taken from his arms and was separated from him without knowing where he was for 8 months.
Oh my.
And so for me, that really raised the question, like, who's behind this? Why are they doing it? And in order to answer that question, I felt that I had to dive into the story of Stephen Miller, the man who's behind the immigration policies, behind the Muslim ban, behind the gutting of the refugee admission system, behind not only all of these cruel immigration policies, but also the rhetoric of Donald Trump. He's one of his primary speech writers and has ensured from 2015 onward that Donald Trump spoke in the most offensive way possible.
That's the perfect way to put it. It is offensive. And yet, you know, Stephen Miller is not a seasoned professional by any means. I mean, he came to Donald Trump's attention through Jeff Sessions, right? He worked in Jeff Sessions' office in the Senate, yeah?
Exactly. I mean, it was a case of just networking, really. I mean, but Stephen Miller had no policy background. He was made Donald Trump's senior policy advisor, was essentially put in charge of the entire Department of Homeland Security, which has this very broad mandate to protect the American people from pandemics and domestic terrorism and cyber warfare and, you know, all kinds of threats. But he turned it into something that was laser focused on keeping out families from Latin America and from Africa. But it started when he was, you know, he got in touch with the Trump campaign while he was working as communications director for Jeff Sessions. That was his background as a public relations flack. And he, you know, at the age of 31, was put in charge of making policies for this country.
That's astounding. The other thing that's astounding is, look, he grew up in Santa Monica, California, not exactly a bastion of right-wing ugliness. I mean, I lived in Santa Monica for a while. I know you're in San Diego. I was down there as well for about a year. And San Diego is quite a bit more conservative than Los Angeles, especially the West Side. How you say he became radicalized as a teenager in Santa Monica?
Exactly. I mean, the fact that he has such a combative conservative ideology, such a reactionary conservative ideology, can be explained by the fact that he grew up in a mostly liberal town. But that is where his radicalization took place. You know, he was going through a hard time as a teenager. His family had lost a lot of money related to their real estate business. His dad was tangled up in numerous legal disputes and bankruptcies, and they had to move from this really nice house in an affluent part of Santa Monica, California, to a slightly less large house. And and then he had to go to public high school instead of a private high school. Aww. And so he was feeling displaced. He was feeling vulnerable. And this is when you see this man named David Horowitz, who I write about in my book, a former Marxist turned right-wing radical, come into Stephen Miller's life and become almost like a father figure to him. He provides him with a framework to sort of, you know, blame everyone else for everything that was going wrong in his life. And he decided, you know, because David Horowitz introduced him to this idea, that the United States faces an existential threat in the form of multiculturalism and in the form of the Democratic Party partnering with people of color, and that he needed to do everything that he could to fight this. And this is why you see him attacking the immigration system and destroying the United States' global reputation as a beacon of hope and refuge for people fleeing persecution across the globe. You know, he believes that if you have too many brown and black families here, then you somehow lose the character of this nation. And these are ideas that, as I show in my book, you know, David Horowitz basically told him that all of the things that we hold dear in society, things like equality, freedom, justice, that these are all products of white men. That idea is obviously ahistorical. It ignores the central role of people of color in our history, as well as in the civil rights movement, to make these once false ideals actually true. But a teenage Stephen Miller was you know, gullible, vulnerable, and he decided to, you know, make this his a life mission to attack multiculturalism and to maintain a white majority in this country.
Wow. And it's astounding. First of all, you know, we've delved into religion on the show a few times in this week. I don't normally talk religion. I'm an atheist Jew, but this is the thing that gets me. First of all, Horowitz is a Jewish name. So this is a Jewish man who befriended this young teenager, Stephen Miller, who is also Jewish. His family's Jewish. And for them to adopt this white nationalistic persona and attitude and ideology is frankly stomach churning to me. What is Stephen Miller's family like this, or did he totally go against the entire family?
Well, he went against most of the family. I mean, most of the family, with the exception of his, I would say probably his father, they're pretty liberal and they're pretty pro-immigrant. And, you know, his grandmother, Stephen Miller's grandmother on his mother's side, Ruth, she dedicated her retirement to compiling the family history so that her grandchildren, like Stephen Miller, would never forget the value of people who come to this country speaking no English and with nothing but the clothes on their backs. And also to record for them the dangers of demonization, because Stephen Miller's great-grandparents came to this country fleeing nationalist agitators who were scapegoating the Jewish people for everything that was going wrong in the country at the time. They came here from Eastern Europe for that reason. And these are lessons that his grandmother recorded for him, that his, you know, his, one of his aunts told me she thinks he should be tried for crimes against humanity. Wow. For ignoring these lessons, and not only ignoring them, but directly attacking them. It's not just white nationalistic. It's like truly a white nationalist agenda. And, you know, he is pulling policies directly from think tanks that were created by eugenicists and white supremacists, particularly a man named John Tanton, who believe in population control for non-white people. And this is why their policies primarily target families who are breaking no laws, because it's not about national security. It's not about law and order. It is about re-engineering the demographic flows into this country to keep brown and black families out. And this is why a majority of the people who are affected are people who are simply coming here with their children and who white nationalists see as a threat to the demographics of this country.
And there was just a new report in the last couple of days that tells us more about the family separation policy at the border. And what we learned is there was a big meeting in the Situation Room, of all places, where Stephen Miller, this was his idea, taking babies away from their mothers. And they went around the room for a show of hands. Stephen Miller led this meeting, demanding a show of hands of everybody in the room about this child separation policy. And it was almost unanimous, except for Kirstjen Nielsen. And the only reason she was against it was not for any moral reason, was because she didn't think logistically they could handle it. Right. This is his policy. This comes out in recent days. And this is why, sorry, I have no sympathy that Stephen Miller has now been diagnosed with COVID-19. I'm astounded.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and it, part of it, as I delve into my book, like, even though he came from a progressive city, he also came from California at a time when California was very different from the California that it is today. And people were scapegoating immigrant families at the time. I remember there were these advertisements that would run on television, because Stephen Miller and I are roughly the same age, and we grew up in California at around the same time. And there were these advertisements that would run that were paid for by the governor that showed immigrant families coming across the border. And there was this ominous voice saying they keep coming. And there was just, you know, statewide anti-immigrant hostility, statewide bipartisan attacks on social services for immigrant children, on bilingual education, on affirmative action. And so Stephen Miller truly is a product of that environment, that California of the 90s, which is so different from the California that we have today, but which was sort of a microcosm for what we're seeing nationally today. Because, you know, California was seeing a rapid demographic shift. Non-Hispanic white people were becoming a minority for the first time that decade. Mm-hmm. And you saw this sort of white fear, white backlash, this idea that there was a quote unquote third world apocalypse coming, that the third world was taking over, that it was going to be the end of the world. Obviously, that did not happen, because, you know, multiculturalism is not an existential threat to anyone. No. But this is a conspiracy theory that is now seeing a resurgence again on a nationwide level, that Stephen Miller learned, was indoctrinated in as a kid, and is now perpetuating from within the White House.
It's just stunning. I wonder, is there any tension between Stephen Miller and Jared and Ivanka, who are ostensibly Jewish? I mean, they say they are, although I don't see any evidence of it, and they play along with Trump's anti-Semitism, which seems to be on display all the time. Is there friction there?
Well, no, because, I mean, they do disagree on ideas, but Stephen Miller has made sure that he doesn't create any conflicts with Kushner or Ivanka, because he understands that in order to stay on Trump's good side, he needs to make peace with his family and not rub anybody the wrong way. And this is one of the reasons that Stephen Miller is officially now the longest lasting advisor in the White House.
Right.
Outside of the president's own family. And it's because he knows how to, you know, suck up to the president. He knows how to make sure that he's managing that relationship in a intelligent way. And one of the ways is to ensure that he keeps the relationship with Kushner and Ivanka positive. So Kushner has a much more liberal immigration agenda. He's willing to bring in immigrants who on work visas and you know, high-skilled immigration visas. But Stephen Miller wants all of that gone. But he's willing to compromise. And the only reason we haven't seen these things completely slashed to zero is because he's been sort of compromising with Kushner and Ivanka on that. And it's one of the reasons that we saw the family separation policy officially end. You know, Ivanka was not into it, and she convinced her father that they needed to stop it. At least that was one of the reasons that they allegedly stopped it.
Allegedly.
But right. Allegedly. I say allegedly because, in fact, what's happening is that we continue to see separations at the border, mm-hmm. and we have been seeing them since January of 2017 when Trump took office, because Stephen Miller, as I show in the book, he signed an executive order. Trump signed it, but Stephen Miller wrote it, an executive order giving the Department of Homeland Security free rein to detain any immigrant who came into contact with them, regardless of their criminal record. So Obama had this prioritization where they went after usually people who'd committed serious crimes. And Stephen Miller took that away. And because they were detaining and detaining and detaining anyone, that meant that they were separating their children from their parents so that they could keep these people locked up. And that's why you continue to see it today.
So this it's all astounding. The fact that he was a communications flack in Sessions' office, I didn't realize that. And he goes from there to being the president's like chief advisor and speechwriter and everything. It makes you wonder, doesn't it? What this? He's a twerp. But then again, Trump has twerps. He's hired some kid who's still in college to do his vetting to make sure that White House staffers are sufficiently loyal to the president. It's really scary stuff. Is there any connection between Stephen Miller's work on these issues and this administration's horrible response to the coronavirus pandemic?
Absolutely. I mean, that's a great question. And from my reporting for the book, it's clear. I spoke to a number of officials who say that Stephen Miller's tunnel vision for civil immigration issues left the Department of Homeland Security completely unprepared to deal with a real crisis like a pandemic. Wow. And you also see Americans left more vulnerable to a range of other real threats like domestic terrorism, like right-wing extremism, which is the number one Homeland Security we're facing today outside of the pandemic. And so, and this is partly because Stephen Miller, from day one, narrowed the focus of the Department of Homeland Security, transferred out anyone who agreed with him, disagreed with him, gutted the Department of Homeland Security so that its leadership positions are now, most of its leadership positions are either vacant or held by people in acting capacity, right, including the acting secretary, Chad Wolf. And this is because it gives them more flexibility. It gives Trump more flexibility to fire them, and it turns them into puppets, essentially, for Stephen Miller. This is a department that is supposed to be in charge of responding in the event of a public health crisis like the coronavirus, and which, instead of focusing on distributing masks and medical equipment, the focus was on suspending green card access for the poor. The focus was on shutting down the asylum system at the U.S.-Mexico border. The focus was on targeting international students. So really just scapegoating, which is essentially just pure distraction from the real issue and the science, and ultimately left Americans more vulnerable. And this is what you get when you put a 31-year-old public relations flack in charge of policies.
Exactly. We're speaking with Jean Guerrero. She's a reporter from the San Diego area. You work at the San Diego PBS station, yes? Or a TV station?
So I'm now a freelancer for NPR and okay. the PBS NewsHour. But previously I was with the San Diego affiliate, yes.
That's what I thought. And her book is called Hate Monger, Stephen Miller, Donald Trump, and the White Nationalist Agenda. It just blows my mind that, again, you don't find many Jews in the white nationalist movement. These are the people who were marching through Charlottesville. Again, remember, it was the white nationalists along with the KKK people holding those torches and chanting, Jews will not replace us. But this is who Stephen Miller has aligned with. Now, he also got married in the last year or two, and his wife, Katie, who is, I think, the first lady's or Mike Pence's press person, or
exactly.
Yeah, she actually was diagnosed with coronavirus first, and I thought, ooh, he's going to get it next, and he didn't. So right. I guess maybe, you know, he doesn't kiss his wife, but he must suck up to Donald Trump all the time because he got it very fast when Trump was diagnosed. Do we have any clues as to what type of case he has, or if Donald is pushing his designer drugs down Stephen Miller's throat?
Well, we don't know how serious it is in the case of Stephen Miller. We do know he's in quarantine right now. We know that it's possible. I mean, he was seen traveling with Hope Hicks, who got it a few days before Donald Trump, or a day before Donald Trump. He was also in the preparation room before the debate between Trump and Biden, and he was helping Trump with that. Often, Stephen Miller will play the part of Trump's political opponent, and they'll just be, you know, screaming in each other's faces. And so it's possible that he got a high viral load from if in fact, Trump was positive prior to the debate, which we don't know because they haven't released any details about when his last negative test was. But we know he's in quarantine and that he's trying to recover. And because Donald Trump sees him as a son, he is a very beloved person of Donald Trump's, as much as Trump is capable of feeling affection for people outside of his family. And it is possible and perhaps even likely that Trump is ensuring that he gets good health care.
Oh, God. This whole thing it's like a comedy of errors. It's just so depressing. It is the worst dystopian movie I've ever seen. And unfortunately, I've seen it too often over the last almost 4 years. I want it to be over already. How long did you spend on this book? And was it tough getting into Stephen Miller's head?
Yeah, so I mean, I interviewed more than 100 people who knew him, colleagues, friends, family. I reviewed hundreds of pages of documents, including court records and private correspondence between Stephen Miller and his mentors. I had to do this in a record time, 6 months. I was given the green light on the book deal May 2019.
And
we turned the book for the fall because we were expecting to put it out in May, but then the pandemic sort of shifted everything later in the year. But immersing myself in the world of Stephen Miller was definitely a head-spinning process. I approached the book with a completely open mind. I wanted to understand Stephen Miller. I wanted to see if perhaps he had been unjustifiably vilified and demonized and caricatured. And I wanted to make sure that I painted a three-dimensional portrait of a human being. So, I spoke to his friends, his family. I read every single book that I learned inspired Stephen Miller to try to get inside his head and see his way of seeing the world. But what's interesting is that normally when you spend time getting to know somebody, the more you get to know them, the more complex they become, the more layered they become. Right. With Stephen Miller, the opposite happened. The more I got to know about him, the less complex he became. In his childhood, I found his humanity in his childhood, when he was trying to get his father's attention and things like that. But over time, he becomes less complicated. And that's just what happens. It's a case study in radicalization. It is what happens when someone is consumed by an ideology and, ceases to be really anything else. His own friends tell me they feel that he's become consumed by this mission and has lost all of the lightheartedness that he used to have.
Wow. I think we got one little peek into his soul and his insecurities a few months back when he was on one of the Sunday shows, and all of a sudden we noticed his hair was a little different, he had sprayed on like a hairline, like spray paint or something, spray hair, because he's, got a very, very receding hairline, especially for someone who's only in his early 30s. And he sprayed on this thing, and he must be a really insecure, unhappy man. That's the only thing I could figure from that.
Yeah, I mean, he doesn't express the insecurity in the ways that normally people express insecurities, but, ultimately someone who becomes so obsessed with an extremist view of the world is clearly trying to, overcome something. And for me, it seemed clear that something was his feeling of displacement, his feeling of having lost his place in line as a kid, just wanting to be perceived as an elite and feeling that the only way to do that was to systematically target his classmates of color and then, communities of color across the country.
Unbelievable.
And he was losing his hair very early on in his life. His friends tell me that it started, in his teenage years.
Oh, wow. Oh, it's so, so sad. Maybe that had an effect on his psyche and why he turned out to be such a miserable, sorry excuse for a human being. Jean Guerrero, thank you for putting your life on hold and writing this. I can't imagine immersing myself in somebody that despicable for a project like this, but I guess I'm glad you did because it's information we should know just to be prepared. And, if karma is a thing, Stephen Miller's going to have a rough few weeks ahead of him. Anyway, the book is called Hate Monger, Stephen Miller, Donald Trump, and the White Nationalist Agenda. Jean Guerrero, thank you so much. I'm saying, Lisa,
there's a reporter named Lisa Guerrero who actually bought a house, my house, in the Hollywood Hills when I moved out. So that, her name is on my mind. Anyway, Jean Guerrero is your name. Thank you so much for joining us today. I really appreciate your time and expertise, and more power to you for doing this.
Thank you so much. I appreciate your time.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye. All right. We've just got a few minutes left, and I thought I should leave you with something fun. I played a song. You know, I like to play song parodies, and it's Friday, so I want it to end on an up note. And I played a song when we were on a break last week that I've gotten more response to than most of the other things I've played. And in fact, early this morning, somebody wrote to me and asked you, can you please send me that song? And so, I'm going to play it for you. You'll get the hang of it pretty quickly. You'll figure out the lyrics. Hold on. I got to get the right screen up here. No, that's not it. This is it. All right. I think this is it. Is it? Yeah. All right. So, sing along when you figure out the tune. It goes something like this.
Up all the fucks I have to give. I love my mama and my daddy. I love my wife and my son. I love picking on this old guitar, but I fucking hate Donald Trump. Yeah, I love the U.S. Constitution, but I fucking hate Donald Trump.
Oh, that needs a round of applause, doesn't it? Let's see if I can get my hand clapping together fast enough. I don't even know who did that. It was a video. Oh, that's really loud. A video I found not too long ago, and I just fell in love with it, and I downloaded it, and so I have it here, and it's, I fucking hate Donald Trump. I guess we have time for one more. You know, in the wake of the debate, our friend Lauren Mayer came out with another ditty really quickly. So, we've got time. Take it away, Lauren Mayer. Here we go.
After the vice presidential debate between a tough, smart woman and a sleepy Stepford mate, where I'm still speaking wasn't just a suggestion, leaving us with just one question. Has Mike Pence ever let a woman finish? Constantly interrupting, sounding so tinnish. Both the moderator and Harris, he tried to diminish. Let him talk, is that too much to ask? I guess his fear and outrage were brimming by knowing his electoral prospects are dimming. Plus being alone on stage with not one but two women. Guess that's why Mother forgot her mask. From men like Pence, please spare us. Whether in bed or the boardroom, there's slime. How many others besides Senator Harris have had to say, I would like equal time? Whenever Kamala smiled, we knew he was in for a bruising. And even apparently the fly knew he's losing. From his mouth and his eyes, seems the lies were oozing. Of his rudeness, there is no defense. Since he won't let a woman finish, good thing a woman gets to finish Mike Pence.
Oh, yeah. And with that, Lauren Mayer, a woman gets to finish Mike Pence. Damn straight. And that's how we finish a week. I didn't want to leave you with, you know, the taste of Stephen Miller in your mouth. Ugh. Sorry about that. I think it's interesting. We need to know this stuff. And honestly, if he hadn't come down with the COVID, I probably wouldn't have interviewed her about that book. But now we can say, karma, it's a bitch. All right, everyone, have a great weekend. Don't forget, I'm in for Brad Friedman on the broadcast tonight. You can get it on the Progressive Voices Network at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific, or go to bradblog.com anytime after that and listen. And I'll see you back here Monday. Thanks for listening, everyone. Have a great weekend. Bye.